Today, we're chatting with Grant about his experience with low vision for Global Accessibility Awareness Day, or GAD. Could you please introduce yourself and tell us one thing you're doing at the moment? Grant is being interviewed over Zoom. He's wearing a white shirt sitting in front of a white background.
Hey, first name's Grant. One of the interesting things that I've done is I've done about 15 years of martial arts, which is just a real passion of mine that I do on the side. I just find it keeps me fit and my mind sharp.
Are there any common misconceptions you come across about low vision?
The biggest thing is the assumption that everyone with low vision has the same low vision. And if I make it bigger, it's easier. We go with the assumption that it's sort of one size fits all. And instead of having conversations and asking people with vision impairments or whatever disability it might be, just assuming that making all the writing really big, but if there's lots of big writing and you can't find the content that you want, you've kind of blown the benefit of what you've done. So it's really about keeping it simple and not assuming that everyone with disability has the same challenges.
Do you use any technology to help you access digital content?
I use them for everything. I do. I'm a bit of a power user. I use them for banking, for navigation, for information, social media. I mainly use magnification, Windows magnification. It magnifies the screen, the text up to a size that I can read it. Alternatively, I'll be using a magnifying glass on the screen. So it magnifies everything on the screen. So then I'm only seeing a portion of the screen. So I have to then move the mouse left and right to bring into focus what I want to see. So you're only ever really working with maybe a quarter of the screen. And I do reverse polarity to help with glare. And if there's a lot of text to be read, I then use a screen reader to help with getting through the volume of work that I have to get through on a daily basis. And especially accessibility apps, I use them for scanning. If I'm trying to read some text, if I'm somewhere and I need to have a bit of text read to me, I'll often just get the app open and scan text and have that read to me. So whether that's a supermarket for reading large amounts, or I just use magnification on the screen of the phone.
Are there any common barriers you face when accessing digital content?
The main thing on the web, that the real challenges are pop-ups over text, and you're trying to magnify, and when you magnify things up, you get overlays come over what you're trying to read. So then you've got to try and put it back to normal size and clear the pop-ups. If the text is a really bad contrast, and if you've got like lime green on a white background or things like that, so it's really hard to, you can't get the contrast, even if the phone's got high contrast turned on, trying to make that legible is very difficult. And so it really gets down to clutter and pop-ups and overlays. And if you've got menus and you try and navigate through them, but when you go through one, other ones pop up and you're thinking, where am I now? So you've got to go back and try again. That's probably the biggest thing. So if it's just when it's cluttered, contrast is not there and pop-ups get in the way, they're probably the three biggest frustrations.
Do you have an example of a positive online experience?
Some of the banking apps are really good. Credit to them. I find their website very easy to use. It's clean. It's simple. I can scroll up and down. Not perfect. There's a couple of little sections that I'd love to change because I have to zoom in and found my own way of doing things. But they haven't cluttered it. And where they do have advertising, it's in a separate page and they sort of lead you there, but you know you're going there. They're not cluttering your experience. So that's actually one of the better ones that I've used. Outside of some of the new accessibility apps like Seeing AI that I use on my iPhone, and that does spot reading where I point the phone and text is read to me, and that's incredibly empowering, especially if you're visiting sites like museums and things where they have an object with a plaque next to it, and I can put AirPods in and have that read to me. Is you don't have to have someone read all this information to you all the time. You can just walk around and have that independence, and it's changed my whole opinion of those sort of places like museums and things, which I always found I could never quite follow what these things were because you couldn't get close and you couldn't read the description. So it's been things like that. I find it fantastic.
Do you have an example of a negative online experience?
It's when their links are all over the place and their submit buttons are off the the viewing area of the screen and things like that, and having to sort of scan left, up and down all over the place. And sometimes it may have been right in front of you. And that's then you feel a bit embarrassed that you haven't followed it when you've gone asking someone else for help or rung the organization. And then they say it's just down there. You just have to select yes or no, whatever it might be. That's disempowering. And it's just the frustration levels come up. And I think what we're really trying to do is just assimilate and be, you know, just as capable as the next person and not feel like you have to apologize that you can't do something.
If you had a magic wand, what would be one thing you would want to change to make everyday life more accessible?
I think in a perfect world, if that's we had that wand happening, that would be getting people to ask more open questions and you know, reserving judgment before they sort of wonder why you're doing something or asking a particular question. I mean, not everybody presents with a cane, or they may have a hearing aid behind, you know, long hair, whatever the disability might be. And I think there's a fair bit of judgment or questioning as to, well, it's right there. Can't you see, can't you hear type thing? And I think that's where the biggest barrier, and I know a lot of people will walk in and say something along the lines of, I'm low vision, or I don't have great sight, would you mind telling me? But you're having to then tell your story to the world and to someone and people around you. And I think if you had that magic wand that you're referring to, I think it would be just being prepared to accept and run with the question in spite of your reasoning. You know, it might not seem logical, but they wouldn't be asking if they didn't need to know.
Why do you think it's important to raise awareness about accessibility?
I think any focus on that Global Accessibility Awareness Day, the more there is on that, the better. I think people often don't realise, they might see something that looks fantastic graphically, but they don't realise how much they're alienating certain parts of the community. And if I've got a choice between two websites, and it could be banking, it could be anything, if one is really accessible and the other one is challenged, there's my decision made. That's the organisation I would go with. So if people step back and actually think about that, or reach out to people like Vision Australia to check over their websites to ensure that they are accessible, it's incredibly powerful, and I just can't encourage them to do that enough.
For this year's GAD, let's get talking, thinking, and learning about accessibility and inclusion, and the more than 1 billion people with disabilities. This video was produced by Vision Australia's Digital Access Consulting Team. Music by bensound.com. If you would like help conducting inclusive research for your product or service, you can contact Digital Access Consulting at digitalaccess@visionaustralia.org.